Okay, the meeting will please come to order. This is a duly advertised meeting of the Joliet Zoning Board of Appeals. In our capacity, we hear petitions for relief from the strict provisions of the city ordinance. In matters of this type, the decision of this board is final in respect that it does not go to the mayor, the city council, for any further action. If you disagree with our decision, you do have recourse in a court of record. We also hear petitions for variations of land use. In matters of this type, we act as an advisory committee to the mayor and city council, making a recommendation either for or against it. Final decision on land use is made by the mayor and the city council. Secretary, call the roll, please.
Ms. Darley?
Here.
Mr. Ferguson?
Here.
Mr. Graham?
Here.
Ms. Nevadas?
Here.
Ms. Powers?
Here.
Mr. Riggs?
Here.
Mr. Hennessy?
Here. Are we sticking to the agenda? We got any special requests?
Mr. Chairman, there are two items that need to be addressed. Number 9 on the petition, that's 2016-15. There is a request to table that for 2 months, so that would be the June Zoning Board hearing. And then item number 10 on the agenda, we'd like to move that up to the first item that's heard. That's 2016-16. And I guess staff would ask for a motion for tabling first on item number 9.
Petition 2016-16 is Center Point Joliet Terminal Railroad. Is anyone here on that? Okay, there's been a request to table it. I'm going to...
No, no, the tabling of number 9, 2016-15, yeah.
Okay, 9. That's 15. That's SS Express Lines. Anyone here on that one? We have a motion, a request to table by the staff.
Motion to table.
Second.
We have a motion and second to table the petition. Call the roll.
Mr. Ferguson?
Aye.
Mr. Graham?
Aye.
Ms. Nevadas?
Aye.
Ms. Powers?
Aye.
Mr. Riggs?
Aye.
Ms. Darley?
Aye.
Mr. Hennessy?
Aye. And you want to go to 2016-16 now?
Yes.
Okay, Center Point Joliet Terminal Railroad. Let's hear that one.
Why was it tabled?
Mr. Secretary?
The first one was tabled because I believe the petitioner is looking at additional land to acquire for the project. So before they wanted to bring that forward, they wanted to explore some options for purchasing more land.
More land?
They're looking at those options.
Petition has been tabled. There is no discussion. Let's proceed.
Petition number 2016-16, the applicant and owner is Center Point Joliet Terminal Railroad, LLC. Location is 3930 Cedar Creek Drive. Their request is a variation. They are requesting a variation to allow shipping container stacking, and that would be 3 containers high, within the I-TC, and that's the Intermodal Terminal Industrial Park Zoning District. Site-specific information. The 11.9-acre subject site comprises part of Lot 37, Block 3, and the Center Point Intermodal Center at Joliet Subdivision. The existing zoning is I-TC, and again, that's Intermodal Terminal Industrial Park Zoning. Surrounding zoning land use and character. To the north is undeveloped, and that's IT. To the south is undeveloped, unincorporated Will County. To the east is industrial with IT zoning. To the west is residential. Again, that is unincorporated Will County. Applicable regulations are as noted. The Community Design Review Board met at its meeting on April 7th. Minutes of that meeting are available. General discussion. The approval of the requested variation on container stacking will allow the development of the Center Point site with a 121,000 1,680 square foot transload facility. The container storage area is being proposed north of the future building. The building and the Cedar Creek floodplain vegetation will act as screening from the adjacent properties. The building height is proposed to be 35 feet high, and the three high container stacking will not exceed 28.5 feet. It should be noted that the nearest residence will be approximately 1,000 feet from the future development. And that concludes the staff report, Mr. Chairman.
Petitioner present. I swear the evidence you're about to present is the truth under penalty of law.
Yes, I do, sir.
Name and address, please.
Michael Hansen, attorney, 735 Essington Road, Joliet, attorney for the petitioner. We adopt the report of the staff, please. Recommend approval.
Questions by the board? We haven't seen you in a while, Mr. Hansen. You don't have very much to say today.
No, that's true, Your Honor.
Any questions by the board? Comments? Anyone in the audience wish to speak in favor? Anyone opposed? Chair closes.
There's an opposition.
Was there a hand up back there?
Yes, sir.
Oh, I'm sorry. I couldn't see you. Come forward. There you go. I must swear you in, ma'am. You swear the evidence you're about to present is the truth under penalty of law. May I have your name and address?
Judy Kreiser, 23656 Vetter Road in Elwood.
Mm-hmm.
We got an Elwood mailing address, but we actually live fairly close. In fact, right up the end of our road, they're putting in the Mars warehouse. You know, our concern is there's so many trucks going down that road already. There's nothing saying how many are going down that road already, Center Point Way. How many are going to that facility every day? Our concern is you know, if they stack three high, they're going to come back with a variance. Oh, let's stack six high. How many of those containers are going to stay at the site? There's nothing saying how many are going to be sent out. How many of the containers are going to, how long are those containers going to stay there? And what's going to happen after the facility is closed? There's nothing saying that. I mean, we live out there. We deal with these trucks every day. The other day they were coming back from on Lairway Road from 53 all the way to Patterson Road. Just a line of trucks. We're finding it hard to even maneuver because there's so many trucks. There's 10 families left out there fairly close to these intermobile facilities, the warehouses and that. And we're not the only ones going down that road. You know, and it's become hazardous because the people going down Schweitzer Road, when they get to the intermobile, we have a problem with trucks coming out of the intermobile turning right. They're supposed to turn left and go out to Arsenal Road, which they don't do. You know, it's become a hazard because you're watching trucks going across on Patterson Road, and you see a truck pulling out of the intermobile, and then it looks like they're turning left, and all of a sudden they're coming at you because they decided they're going to turn right. You know, Mark, this whole thing is like you keep approving these people to put this in and that in, and there's no solution to the truck problem. I don't think you should let anybody come in anymore till the solution is set. You keep on putting, oh, we're going to have studies, and we're going to have studies, and the meanwhile, the trucks are getting more and more and more. You know, people should drive out there and spend the day and just watch the trucks. See how many trucks there are. You know, when you get out there to turn on the Lairway Road from the intermobile, and there's trucks from Patterson Road from the intermobile all the way down to 53. You know, that's dangerous, and, you know, and putting that Hoboken Bridge in isn't going to solve anything anyway because they're not going to take it. They're not going to pay the toll. They'll just keep getting on 53. And then if you do get the Hoboken thing, you have trucks traffic going down Jefferson and going through Shanahan, which Shanahan, you know, years ago was complaining about the truck traffic. You know, I don't think there should be any more containers or anything brought in, you know, until they, this is all, it's just ridiculous. It's piling dirt on top of dirt. You know, until these things are done, I mean, how many of those containers are going to stay there forever? You know, what's going to happen when everybody moves out in the future? You know, it's going to be like Chicago. You got stacks and stacks of containers that aren't going anyplace. And you aren't getting that much revenue from them places. You know, it's been established you aren't getting that much, revenue because you don't own the land to start with. You know, there's questions that need to be answered before anything else is done.
Mr. Hanson?
Yes, Your Honor, members of the commission. You know, we've vetted these questions many times before. As everybody is aware, this huge center point area, very big economic engine for the city of Joliet. Certainly, we acknowledge from time to time there are, you know, truck issues, et cetera, down there. But, you know, we think that we've satisfied all those concerns. We take a lot of pride in our safety, a lot of pride in the way that the things are done. As far as this specific piece of property and the question of the variance and the question of stacking, as you will note, we've worked with the city, worked with staff to ensure that, you know, adequate protections have been given to any neighbors. You know, they have Audubon to the east, which is a big neighbor that creates a lot of noise in the area. We have Navovia to the east, another facility. The Mars facility will be coming in. This is an intermodal area where you're going to have trucks and concerns. There's a great deal of tree shrubberage in the area, which is going to provide a nice buffer. We worked to exactly where the stacking is going to occur, such that it's not going to be higher than the building, so it's going to be out of sight to anybody on the road or anybody visibly. We think we've satisfied any of these concerns. We understand there are still some people residing on Vetter Road. We understand that, but you know, this has become an intermodal area, and I think our record, our safety record, has proven that we're doing everything possible to take care of all these issues.
Thank you. Anyone else wishing to speak in opposition? I swear the evidence you're about to present is the truth under penalty of law.
Yes.
Name and address, please.
23656 South Vetter Road. I live with my mother on Vetter Road at 23656 Vetter Road. This
name.
Kathy Arthas. And this property that he proposes, you see the houses there? And that all where that thing is mapped out is basically all woods over there and that. I mean, it could be taking a lot of trees and everything. You realize the quality of the air, the impact on the environment. Are we not talking about climate changes in this world? You know, and it ain't gonna be much of a buffer there. How long are they gonna leave one little thin strip of trees left? And every day we walk out, we're gonna look across the street and we're gonna see this. Why do we gotta put up with that? You know, you guys don't care. You don't live out here. This is not where you live. This is not where you go to bed at night. This is not where you enjoy yourself. You know, I mean, they got plenty of land. They could put containers somewhere else. And when they first incorporated everything here, no container stacking was supposed to go on anywhere, anyway. So I think, you know, why do you keep taking trees down? Trees are irreplaceable. Yeah, sure, you could plant a new tree, but it takes 100 years for that tree to get big enough to where it can do anything. You know, we have to worry about our environment here. You guys just keep letting it happen. Then you hear governments and, you know, all these countries getting together and the scientists are telling you about the climate change. We need to stop taking trees down. We're not gaining anything. You know, all our jobs, all the corporations are moving out of the U.S., Mexico, China, and that, and all they're doing is then having us build warehouses here in America to then them to build their stuff out of the country and then bring their stuff here to store. And I think that's wrong, too. We're encouraging this. You know, what happened to our great USA? This is not what our founding fathers fought for. I don't think we should have to put up with having to see that. I mean, the noise that these you don't hear at nighttime when they got the cranes running over the Union Pacific Yard and hear these containers getting slammed down. It sounds like bombs going off in your backyard. Try sleeping through that. I mean, why? Sorry, Michael.
You know, Mr. Chairman, members of the commission, CenterPoint is bringing a very reputable company here to Joliet, bringing a lot of jobs, economic development. We recognize some of the issues that Kathy has brought to the attention. We think we've taken the steps to prevent those. There really are not going to be a great amount of trees in that area going to be taken down, and the trees are going to remain for the fact that it's not going to be a developable area, and they do provide the necessary buffer to these residents. And as indicated, these residents in question, they're going to be living 1,500 to 2,000 feet away from this specific site, so.
Okay, with the quandary down in Springfield now, is there any progress being made on any construction on these roads around that area or on the new bridge? Is there anything at all going on?
You know, talks are still going on with respect to the bridge. I mean, it's obviously a huge project. You know, it's just something that it's one kind of step at a time at this particular point in time. Believe me, CenterPoint is working on that matter, and I think they're very hopeful that it's going to get solved fairly soon, so.
Well, it is part of the largest inland port in the country, maybe the world, as far as I know. And that's what the purpose of the property is. Anyone else wishing to speak in opposition?
The same lady's got her hand up back there. Mm-hmm. She's got her hand back up there behind Mike.
Oh, you've already spoken, ma'am. I'll only get one shot. Anyone else?
What? Nobody gets to speak things when
there's. There is no one else. The chair is closing the petition to the floor and asking the board for discussion and a vote.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Is that a motion to approve?
Yeah.
We have a motion and a second to approve the petition. Call the roll, please.
Mr. Ferguson?
Aye.
Mr. Graham?
Aye.
Ms. Nevadas?
Aye.
Ms. Powers?
Aye.
Mr. Riggs?
Aye.
Ms. Darley?
Aye.
Mr. Hennessy?
Aye.
Thank you very much.
We're back to the regular agenda, petition 2016-10. Emilio Bravo. Come forward.
Petition number 2016-10. The applicant is Emilio Bravo. Property interest, Mr. Bravo is the business owner and sole proprietor. The owner of the property is Lester Minor III, location 160 South Center Street. Mr. Bravo's request is for a special use permit. He is requesting approval of a special use permit in order to allow an auto mechanic shop. Site-specific information, the 8,700-plus square foot site is zoned I-1, and that's light industrial, and currently contains a 1,816 square foot metal building that was built in 1977. Surrounding zoning land use and character, to the north is residential, that's R3 zoning. To the south is commercial, to the east is commercial, both areas zoned I-1. To the west is residential, zoned R2. Applicable regulations are as noted. The Community Design Review Board met on April 7th. There were no comments concerning Mr. Bravo's request at that meeting. Under general discussion, the petitioner is requesting the special use permit in order to allow an automotive and tire repair facility at the existing site. The building has been in existence for many years, and the property has a long history of industrial uses that previously included automotive repair. A fenced-in parking area is located adjacent to the east side of the building for the main storage area. There is also additional parking along the front of the building adjacent to the three bay doors. Paving of the two parking areas and repair of the fencing are being recommended as a condition of approval. The long-term storage of inoperable vehicles exceeding 10 days and spare parts on the site will be prohibited. If the zoning board desires to approve the special use permit, the following conditions would be included: that the unpaved parking lots be paved as per the requirements of the city's Public Works Department within 90 days of approval, that the existing fencing, including broken and missing slats, be repaired also within 90 days of approval, that there be no long-term storage, and that would be a maximum of 10 days, of inoperable vehicles on site. We have also included the 180-day condition requiring a certificate of occupancy or building permit being applied for within 180 days of the effective date of approval. And finally, should the property be declared a public nuisance, it shall be subject to a rehearing and possible revocation of the special use permit. And that concludes the staff report, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Are both of you going to speak? I must swear you in. You swear the evidence you're about to present is the truth under a penalty of law. Sir, would you raise your hand, please?
Swear.
So swear? Could I have your names and addresses?
Ricardo Martinez, 515 Adela Avenue, Joliet, Illinois.
Emilio Gervasio, 800 East Jackson.
Okay, any comments you'd like to make?
Basically, we're just here because we're trying to open up the business and we're trying to get something going.
Okay, and you are aware of the conditions that have been stated? Can you get that done within 90 days?
Yes, we can.
Have you started on it at all?
Yeah, we started working on the fence already. We started.
I saw you working down there.
We evened up the pavement, but we haven't paved it completely. We just evened up the leveling everything on the floor. We're just going to start paving.
Okay. Any questions about staff?
I have.
Go ahead, darling.
This is a gateway into Joliet coming off of I-80, and there are other repairs to the building to make it look nicer that I think should be included, such as paint. There's peeling paint. There's also gutter repair needed, and I think that those should also be a condition of this. What hours will you be open?
9 a.m. to 5 p.m.
Is that 6 days a week, 5 days a week?
Monday through Saturday.
Monday through Saturday. Have you owned businesses like this before? Is this your first venture into this type of business?
First time that we get a place of our own.
Of your own, but you've worked in the...
Yeah, we were renting another place.
Anything else? Does that building need any other repairs other than what the member stated?
We haven't had it inspected.
So I'd like to incorporate any changes or any repairs into the petition at this time. So can we make it subject?
Where does the business license building department?
They will. Okay. Yeah, they're going to be required to get a business license, and as part of that process, building inspections will inspect the building.
Okay, so is there any need to incorporate Mr. Arley's comments into the motion?
I think so. The paint would probably be above and beyond what building inspections would require.
They sent somebody to inspect the interior of the building, and we had to remodel the bathroom and stuff on the inside already. Because it needed a handicap inside the bathroom. We did all that already.
Yeah.
Questions by the board? Anybody in the audience wish to speak in favor?
I live next door, and I
have... Oh, hold on. Hold up. Is somebody raising their hand back there in favor? Do you want to come forward? Are you two together, or...? Okay. Do you swear the evidence you're about to present is the truth under penalty of law, sir?
Yes, I do.
Name and address.
Russell Wunderlich. My business address is 300 West Allen, Joliet, a neighbor. My residence is in Chicago. Would you care for that address?
No, that's fine.
Okay. I'm in favor of these gentlemen. Of course, we've been in that location since 1967. The building has been left vacant and alone for many years now since one of the Mr. Miners passed away. What I see these gentlemen doing is positive. I support them taking the building over. I think the conditions you've put on them are fair and should be done in respect of the community and the gateway to Joliet. But as a business owner near them, I think what they're doing is positive, and I completely agree with what they're doing, and I hope you do allow them the special use permit.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Ma'am? Just read the evidence you're about to present as the truth under a penalty of law.
I do.
Name and address.
Carolyn Heineman, 711 Morgan Street in Joliet. My name's Carolyn Heineman. I'm president of the St. Pat's Neighborhood Association. This location, 160 South Center, is in our neighborhood. We do not oppose the request for a special use permit. It would be great to have that building in use and good repair and bring employment to the area. However, it has been brought to our attention that the occupants of 160 South Center park on the empty grass lot across from its location to the south. That property is not owned by 160 South Center, and it's not legal to park on a property unless it is paid. We would request that this company refrain from parking on the grass lot, or if they obtain approval to park there, that it be paved and comply with the city ordinance.
Do they own the property?
No.
We can't make it part of the petition then.
No, but we would just like to request that they not.
You're on record, yes, okay, go ahead.
And otherwise, we're very pleased to have this company in our neighborhood.
Thank you. You guys parking cars over there?
There's two cars parked right there. Dummy. And then on the Zacate, basically, no puedes parquear, no estuvo parqueado ahí. Sí, no hemos estado parqueando porque.
Well, if you are, it just came to a screeching halt, so.
Okay, I understand.
Okay.
Yeah, but it's been.
No more parking over there, okay? City, if you want to keep track of that, make sure they're up. Anyone else wishing to speak in favor? Anyone opposed?
I'm not opposed, but I'm not in favor either. I have questions, but I live right.
Come forward. You swear the evidence you're about to present is the truth under penalty of law.
Yes, my name
is. Name and address.
My name is Carolyn White. I live at 158 South Center, which is directly next door. And I do have the same pictures that you have, but I think that if you look at them, you can see that everything is falling down. It's not gonna need just paint and a few things that are there. I've called the city having garbage removed from the backside of the alley. I've had to have animals abated from around my house because possums, squirrels, rats, you name it, have gone inside there. And if you look at my property, you can see that I try to keep it up and have it looking decent. Mr. Wonderlook has been a wonderful neighbor, and the grass is always cut. This does not have grass cut. It doesn't have, and on the inside where the railroad ties are along that fence, as you can see, there's all those automobiles. You can see the shadow of the automobiles that are there. They've been there for over 10 years. That van that was in the front that you can see, there's the van, there's other trucks, and I'm sure those are not yours. Mm-hmm. Those are things that need to be removed before they even get in there. That fence that's on the back side is gonna fall into my yard because the railroad ties have so disintegrated that it's totally ridiculous. I'm not against them, but I am against the fact that nothing has been done, and before they can try and start something, there's gonna have to be more work done on this property.
Thank you.
Well, Mr. You said our 9 to 5?
9 to 6.
No, we're going to have hours. Are you going to be there on Saturdays?
Yeah.
Up until?
Monday.
Do you want to direct your questions, please, to the board?
I'm sorry, but I am upset because.
You stated the hours of operation previously, ma'am.
But I wanted to know, you know, we've stated hours and people say, oh, somebody comes to
well,
pick up a little bit
later.
Well,
then you call up and make a complaint at the time. Don't.
All right, I'm just checking with them because I want to be a good neighbor, but I want them to be a good neighbor also, and I'd like them to adhere to the hours that they're saying, and if it's going to be on Saturday only until 6, that they stick to that.
Well, I'm sure we'll hear from you if they don't. Getting back to my original statement, looking at these, I agree that the building needs a lot. Who's this minor guy? He's the owner of the property, right?
Yes.
Is he going to be responsible for any of these repairs?
The vehicles that were mentioned that had been there for quite a while, do those belong to Mr. Minor?
They're not there anymore.
Oh, they're not?
Oh, they're not.
They've been removed?
Yes, they are. That van is in the front on Ottawa Street.
Hold on, just...
No van there. No, there's not. There's no van.
The camper has been removed?
The camper's there.
There's all those other cars.
Yeah, the camper is mine.
Okay, but there's no long-term storage of vehicles going to be allowed there?
Okay.
When is the city going to make an, you say they haven't made an inspection yet?
Well, if this gets approved, then they'll need to apply for a business license, and at that point, building inspections will do an inspection.
And if it's not in good enough repair, what happens then? You're going to...
Well, they're going to be required, they're going to get a list of...
Violations?
Violations that they'll have to address.
Before they can open?
Will that be addressed before it goes to the council?
No. No, it will be addressed at the time they apply for their business license.
Okay, but we will see that all these things are taken care of, right?
Right.
Okay, I'm going to close the discussion of the floor and ask the board for discussion and a vote. Motion be in order.
I'll move for approval, and I want you guys to know that I wish you the best and that I live pretty close to you, too.
I appreciate it.
I'll be walking by there and checking in.
Whatever you want, no problem.
Okay. I move for approval.
Second.
A motion, second, to approve.
Is that with the conditions of Rebecca's as well?
Subject to the conditions and statements of the city as mentioned. Okay. Poll the board.
We need a second, Mr. Chairman.
There was a second.
A second.
There was, okay.
Ms. Starley?
Aye.
Mr. Ferguson?
Aye.
Mr. Graham?
Aye.
Ms. Nevadas?
Aye.
Ms. Powers?
Aye.
Mr. Riggs?
Aye.
Mr. Hennessy?
Aye. Good luck, gentlemen. Guy Dragisic, petition 2016-11.
Petition number 2016-11. The applicant is Guy Dragisic of Olympic Sign Company. The owner is Hampton Mercury Investment. Location 2211 West Jefferson Street. Their request is for a variation of allowable signage to permit a wall sign that doesn't face a street front. The petitioner is requesting a variation to allow the addition of a wall sign on the west side of the commercial structure. In June 1991, the board approved a variation of a major street setback from 80 feet to 64 feet to allow construction of an atrium addition at this site. Under site-specific information, they're located on the north side of Jefferson Street, west of Hamas. The 5,000-plus square foot brick restaurant was built in 1978. The property is zoned B3, and that's general business zoning. Surrounding zoning, land use, and character. The land use and zoning adjacent to the site is professional office, zone B3, to the north, and commercial, zone B3, general business, to the south, east, and west. Applicable regulations are as noted. The Community Design Review Board discussed this request at their meeting April 7th. There were no subsequent comments from other city departments or agencies regarding the request. Under general discussion, the petitioner proposes to add a 50 square foot set of illuminated channel letters on the west wall of the Baker Square restaurant. The sign will be visible to eastbound vehicle traffic. The sign will also have a similar appearance to the existing front wall sign. The overall sign height will be at 17 feet. And that concludes the staff report, Mr. Chairman.
Do you swear the evidence you're about to present is the truth under penalty of law?
Yes, sir.
Name and address.
Guy Dragisic, Olympic Sign Company, 1130 North Garfield, here representing Baker Square. Staff basically said everything, so we are looking to put a sign on that elevation. And back in, I think it was 91, there used to be neon borders up on that elevation. They were purple at the time, and those were removed quite a while ago. But Baker Square is just hoping to gain some exposure and utilize that wall. And talking to staff, I mentioned to them, too, that the color of the wall is not a good contrast to the letters that they're being proposed. So they're in agreement, and they're going to paint that wall to match the front entrance area.
And that won't, it won't be a flashing light of any kind?
Oh, no, no, sir. It'll be translucent vinyl over the cover with low-voltage LED illumination, so it'll be a constant color. And it'll be exactly, it'll be a mirror image of the sign currently on the front.
Questions from the board? Anyone in the audience wishing to speak in favor? Anyone opposed? Chair closes the petition on the floor and asks the board for discussion and a vote.
I move to approve.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to approve the petition. Call the roll, please.
Ms. Novatis?
Aye.
Ms. Powers?
Aye.
Mr. Riggs?
Aye.
Ms. Darley?
Aye.
Mr. Ferguson?
Aye.
Mr. Graham?
Aye.
Mr. Hennessy?
Aye. Thank you.
Thank you.
Dave, Drive Time Car Sales. Anyone here? Petition 2016-12.
Petition number 2016-12. The applicant is Drive Time Car Sales Company. They are the contract purchaser of the property. The owner is John Boyle, Owen Park Properties, LLC. Location, 1395 North Larkin Avenue. Their request is a special use permit to allow a used car dealership and outdoor sales lot in an existing commercial structure. The petitioner is requesting a special use permit to allow operation of a used car dealership in a commercial structure previously occupied by Century Tile and to allow an outdoor sales lot. The site was initially developed for Frank's Nursery in 1984. A special use permit to allow a resale store in an existing commercial structure was approved June of 2015. A variation to allow two main buildings on one lot was approved in 1987. The variation allowed addition of a small Federal Express drop-off building at the site. The property is located on the west side of Larkin Avenue, north of Ingalls Avenue. Site-specific information, the site consists of a 22,000-plus square foot brick commercial building built on a slab in 1984. The lot size is approximately 3 acres. The site is zoned B3, which is general business zoning. Surrounding zoning, land use, and character. The surrounding land use and zoning includes commercial service and mini warehouse rental facility. Zone B1, neighborhood business to the north, commercial and vacant commercial. Zone B1 to the south, commercial, zone B3 and institutional, and that's the Joliet Catholic Academy. Zoned R2 to the east, and multifamily residential, zoned R5 to the west. Applicable regulations are as noted. The Community Design Review Board reviewed this request on April 7th. There were no subsequent comments from other city departments or agencies or utilities regarding the special use permit request. The petitioner plans to locate a Drive Time used car dealership at the subject site. Drive Time is one of the largest used car dealers in the U.S. A company description and proposed site plan and floor plan are attached. Photographs of the site and a typical front elevation view were also attached to the staff report. The used car sales office will occupy only a portion of the building. Adequate off-street parking is available to serve the business. A special use permit is required to accommodate the auto sales business in this particular zoning district. Should the zoning board desire to recommend approval of the special use permit, the following conditions are recommended. One, the automotive service, such as minor repair, muffler, and oil change, shall not be permitted at this site. Number two, we have included the 180-day condition requiring a building permit or certificate of occupancy being obtained no later than 180 days of approval. Number three, should the property be declared a public nuisance, it shall be subject to a rehearing and possible revocation of the special use permit. And finally, that the business conforms to all applicable building code and business license requirements now and into the future. And that concludes the staff report, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Gentlemen, you swear the evidence you're about to present is the truth under penalty of law?
We have our witnesses stand up in case they do testify.
You're all going to be good boys and do that?
Yes, sir.
Okay, names and addresses.
Mike Martin, 15 West Jefferson Street, Joliet. With me, I also have Mike Martin from the same address. Then I have, Sean, do you want to come introduce yourself?
Sean Fitzgerald, Drive Time, 1720 West Rio Salado Parkway, Tempe, Arizona, 85 53.
Should have rehearsed.
281.
Good afternoon. Grant, excuse me, Grant Courier, Linden Group Architects, 10100 Orland Parkway, Orland Park, Illinois.
Okay.
Thank you, Chairman Hennessy and honorable members of the Zoning Board. I want to thank you for letting us present our case to you. We also have with us is Mr. John Costello, who is an attorney based in Chicago who represents Drive Time in regards to compliance and regulation laws, in particular in regards to lending laws in the state of Illinois. My client seeks a special use permit to operate a used car dealership, and you may be familiar with this site. It used to house the Frank's Nursery and Crafts, and then for the last few years it had Century Tile, although it has sat vacant for in excess of a year. I can also add Mr. John Boyle on behalf of the ownership group is here present today. And my client is a contract purchaser. From a zoning perspective, our application meets the requirements of the zoning ordinance. This is a previous commercial site. Utilities are adequate. They're there on site. Stormwater management is there on site. Access is there on site. My client anticipates putting in excess of $750,000 into a vacant building, improving this building and putting forth their business. As this is a commercial area of Joliet, we believe that our business will not negatively impact the development, as this property has previously been used as commercial. By approving my site, my client will bring great benefits to the city of Joliet. They anticipate they'll generate at least 20 full-time jobs, salaried positions. They anticipate to generate substantial sales tax revenue. Their early anticipations, they're estimating approximately 75 cars will be sold with an average median price of $13,000. That's in excess of $11 million yearly in sales tax revenue. They'll generate real estate taxes as well, plus the improvements made to the property. They also will provide a benefit to the citizens of Joliet. Now, we know subprime lending has a negative connotation and negative assumptions made about it. And most people do make an improper assumption that anyone engaged in subprime lending is automatically a predatory lender, but that's strictly not the case. Subprime lending is a highly regulated industry, and my client takes pride in ensuring that they are following all regulations and putting forth an affordable product and allowing people and citizens of Joliet to buy vehicles who may have had financial difficulty in the past. And as we all know, a vehicle is a key in this area, especially is a key to maintaining, improving, and obtaining employment. We've produced, and I don't know if you've seen it, but we produced a recent Equifax article which described and discussed these general improper assumptions about subprime lending. What my client doesn't do, they don't churn. They don't buy a vehicle, then sell it for the acquisition costs, collect a few payments, and repossess the vehicle. They don't do spot delivery. There's no negative equity from the get-go on these purchases. There's no teaser rates, floating rates, escalating payments. There's no starter ignition locking devices installed. But what they do produce a high-quality product at an affordable rate. Their vehicles are purchased from trusted sources, typically from auctions, sometimes from third-party vendors such as car rental companies. And before a vehicle is brought to the site and put on to sale, it's reconditioned and repaired at one of the reconditioning facilities. And on average, they put $1,200 to $1,500 in each vehicle before it is offered to sale. They take pride in their haggle-free pricing, their transparency on pricing. All their vehicles' prices are listed online, and they're listed on the vehicle at each lot. Any ancillary products or optional products, they take pride in being transparent on the pricing of that. If a customer wants to buy an auxiliary product, they must go through a screen list and see the difference in price over the terms of the loan with that product included. It's a corporately owned. Each dealership is corporately owned. There's a centralized loan processing from sales, financing, maintenance, and collection. It's all corporately and centrally done to ensure compliance with the strict regulations regarding lending. when a customer goes to Dry Time, they get approval first. Not there telling the, they get approval first, and they go through their robust underwriting program. They have an eighth generation credit module that Dry Time believes is 30% more accurate than just your standard FICO credit score. It's based on employment verifications, it's based on income, it's based on down payment. It's not just walking in and saying, my credit score is this, what can you approve me? And the reason for that is because Dry Time retains a vested interest in these loans. They retain ownership of them. They retain ownership of the servicing of the loans. So they have a benefit and they have a goal and an interest in those loans succeeding. They take pride in putting people who may have had financial difficulties back in vehicles they can afford to allow them to work and to allow them to responsibly restore their credit, which as Equifax has determined, subprime lending does help. It does help those who may have had financial difficulties in the past. They monitor their closings, they review their closings. With the customer approval, each of the closing is videotaped. They review in excess of 1,000 closings a month nationwide. They attempt to contact all customers after the closing to confirm that they knew the auxiliary or optional products were optional. And if a customer elects to cancel at that point, they prorate cancellation back to the customer. While Dry Time serves a subprime market, its practices are not predatory. It takes pride in providing its customers a reasonable and responsible avenue to obtain financing to purchase vehicles. It looks forward to becoming a member of the Joliet community. This approval will not only generate substantial tax dollars and full-time jobs, it will provide the citizens of Joliet the resources and the ability to purchase an affordable vehicle. And if you have any questions about our site plan, about our practices, I of course have our team here with us today. Thank you.
Yeah, I noticed in here that it says you're only going to be occupying a portion of the building. Do you have any plan? Who else is going to be in there? What other type of business would be there?
No other. It would just be Dry Time. So their store layouts, these is about 7,000. These about 7,000 square feet. The building obviously is much larger. From the get-go, they're going to use it as just blank storage. Won't be accessible to the public. The front portion will all be used for the actual selling of vehicles and so forth.
Aside from washing and everything else, is there going to be any servicing there?
No, all repairs are done at the reconditioning facilities before they come to the site for sale.
Be washing cars?
There'll be no washing of cars. There's no car wash, but they will clean out vehicles before they're sold.
Yeah, because there's no drainage there for that, so.
But there's going to be no active car wash for customers to pull into, and they don't plan on washing cars once they're on site.
What about storage of cars that are traded in? Are those off the lots immediately or what?
If you can go back to the site plan, Kendall. And along the south side of the building, they're proposing to they're going to put in a fence with a gate, and we've actually updated this site plan slightly over the last day. That will be their holding area. The cars will be held for a short time period before they're shipped off. They're not holding any trade-in vehicles will be placed there until they're shipped.
What kind of fencing are you going to have around to shield you from the other surrounding properties?
There is a back fence already. It's wood with metal poles in the back. We've agreed and we've put it on our updated site plan. We've agreed to make any repairs to that fence as necessary. That fence was previously there when it operated a Century Tile.
Do we have any conditions, Mr. Secretary, on type of fencing?
No, we do not. They have agreed to make the repairs to the existing fence that's there.
Staff is satisfied with the fencing as it is?
Yes.
How many cars will be on the lot?
Right now, the site plan calls for approximately 134 max for display purposes. There is a slight portion of about 23 spots that would be behind that fence, but they don't anticipate the display back there. It can range depending on the time of year, but they anticipate anywhere between 100 to 134 display vehicles.
Questions by the board? Anyone else in your staff wishing to make comments? Anyone in the audience wishing to speak in favor? Anyone opposed? Do you have a spokesperson? Are you all together or?
Mr. Chairman, before they start, we have a response here to a letter that was written by the Cathedral Area Preservation Association. But we don't, I would like to see a copy of the letter that was written. We don't have a copy of that. I don't, anyway, in my stuff.
Is there a copy available here? Denise?
Thank you.
Oh, okay. Did we see?
Can I see this? Oh, you've got it.
Answered. Okay, who were the objections?
I'm sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt you. I wanted to see that.
I am.
Do you swear the evidence you're about to present is the truth under penalty of law?
Yes.
Could I have your names and addresses?
Judy Simpson, 1839 Festival Court.
Thomas Simpson, 1839 Festival Court.
Speak up a little too, please. What comments would you like to make?
Well, we're right behind them. Oh, I'm sorry. We are right behind where they're going to be storing them. And for us, it's more of a safety issue. We have a lot of little kids in that subdivision. The fence that's there, it's just a fence. It doesn't
go around. That's why I was asking about the fencing. Yeah.
It doesn't go around. It doesn't lock. People can literally come in, go through our, you know, our yard. It's a safety issue. With Century 21, it was fine because the customers would park, you know, like in the front, and it was never packed. But now with a car dealership, it's a safety concern. We deal with Toyota. They were there before we were. But with the lights and the intercoms, and I mean, we are never in the dark. Our home is never dark because of the lights at Toyota. But the intercom, we can hear them. So now with this car dealership, it's going to be right there, right behind us. Well, actually, they're right in front of us. But I don't know. I don't feel that would be a proper place for a dealership.
Well, your major concern is the fencing for the security?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
What type of fencing would you like?
I mean, it's all grass area. It would have to go down to where they would have to block
property
it off.
Line, yeah.
Yeah, they would have to block it off to where nobody in their parking lot can come through our yards. Because we have little kids literally, you know, it's a cul-de-sac, so we have little kids that are running back and forth, and it's kid-friendly.
Okay, thank you.
And my concerns are just the same, besides the security issue.
Where do you live, sir?
Same address, 1839 Festival Court. As you can see in your picture, in addition to the safety issue, noise. When Century Tile was there, I understand, you know, there's going to be some noise from the business, but now you're going to have more traffic coming into a used car lot. There's going to be noise, and that fence is inadequate to block noise. We can hear noise, and the way our houses are facing each other, noise amplifies through that whole entire neighborhood. I'm a correction officer. I work second shift, so I sleep most of the time. You know, late at night, and then I get up maybe, you know, mid-morning. There's several police officers that also live in that neighborhood on the next street on Maypole. So we work shift work. There's going to be a lot of noise. And in addition to that, you know, we already have Toyota down the street, and And before that, further down the street on Route 30, there's already another used car lot. There's going to be more traffic in that area. So again, more noise, more lights, and, you know, in addition to the safety issue. And I'm assuming that since there's going to be a used car lot there, the vacant auto service center is gonna open. We've seen people looking at that property already. There used to be a Firestone there, and the gentleman that owned it before, Angelo, was a great neighbor. Pet Boys took it over, and it was horrible. Their employees came in doing burnouts, loud music, which amplified right down our street, and it was just terrible. And we always have people, you know, walking through that area. So I'm opposed to it for, you know, safety, traffic, and a light issue, and as well as noise.
All right, thank you.
The light issue, if it does get approved, are they going to do some sort of lights because of our schools
we'll
right there?
We'll have them respond to your questions when you're okay. Finished, ma'am.
Okay, yeah, because I just thought about that, because we have a high school and a junior high, and I just don't want people peeling out of that parking lot to get across, especially when school is out for our kids. Mm-hmm. So.
Thank you. I'd like to rebut.
First, we had updated our site plan. I'd like to give you a copy. Is there anything, I believe, that addresses the fence issue?
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Has this always been here?
Excuse me, Mike, did we see that? Did staff see the updated?
We did. Yes, do you need another copy?
Yeah, if you could give me a copy, thanks.
Same thing we have.
Thank you.
If you look at it, on the updated site plan, we've got a fence that's going to run along the south side of the building at its front. And that's where the gate's going to be. And there'll be employee parking back there and then the small holding area for trade-in vehicles. The fence will be right here coming down. That's where the gate's going to be put. And then this here will be employee parking and the holding area for cars here. This fence is going to run along here, connect to this fence, and come back up here along, and there's the fence will extend here where it's at, and they're going to put another gate here. So it is going to be blocked off. This is a tree area here from the back portion. My plan is also not opposed to making improvements to that fence. We've discussed that with staff. Second issue I know that was raised was in regards to the light. We've met with staff. We've produced a photometric plan. We've complied with their request into that.
Yeah, I just wanted to address the lights as well. They are LED lights that sit up in the casings, and we produce the photometric plan to make sure that they're not going to be intrusive to our neighbors. So the casings have them pointing more downwards than outwards to prohibit those lights from being intrusive. And as far as the intercom system, we don't use intercom systems. I'm very familiar with what you guys are referring to. They can be obnoxious when they're calling for employees or something across the dealerships, and we're not in favor of those, and we don't use them.
I would just add, this is it's a used car dealership, but it's not your typical used car dealership. They make their buildings, if you look at the photos produced along with our application, you know, these are aesthetically pleasing dealerships. They don't have gimmicks. They don't have inflatables out there. They don't have a loud intercom system blaring.
The city's passing an ordinance to get rid of those now, as a matter of fact.
If staff has any questions.
Any other questions from staff?
What are the hours of operation?
I believe it's 10 to
10 a.m. to 8 p.m. Monday through Thursday, and then 9 to 9 Monday or Friday and Saturday. We're not open on Sundays.
Will people be able to, when you're closed, like other car lots, will people be able to go in and look at the walk through and look at cars while you're not there? You know what I mean? How people do that?
If you're asking if we're going to gate off the public entrances, we don't have any plans to do that now. That's it will remain open.
Okay.
Yeah.
Just wondering.
Is there anyone else wishing to speak?
I just okay.
Go ahead. No.
Go ahead.
Come on forward. If you want to go ahead, make your point.
I just have a concern about that fence across the west side of the property.
Yes.
If that's an open, I don't know what the fence looks like, but if it's open and access, that would allow kids to go through and onto even a portion of that property. I'd like to see something considered to adjust that particular fence.
I think it is open now, but with their fence proposal along there, we'll close off that area.
So there would be no way for anybody from that neighborhood to get onto the property at all?
Well, they would be able to walk around and
around
through the entrance.
You can't control that, but there's no direct access from the west onto that property.
No, and with the fence they're proposing to install from here and here, that's going to block off this entire area at all hours.
So it will be a different fence than the one that's currently there?
They're not opposed to necessarily putting in or upgrading the fence that we've agreed with staff to upgrade, make the upgrades as necessary, and then they're going to install a fence along here, and then bring the fence down from here to here. So the back fence portion that's on the west side is there.
Yeah.
That's a wood board-on-board fence, about 6 foot tall, that's old. In fact, we had first thought it belonged to the apartment complex and not to when Frank's was there. So that's what, you know, but we're not opposed to upgrading that fence as staff would suggest or anything that would help them with noise and security. We don't have a problem with any of that.
So we can make, if a motion is made to approve, we can make it subject to the staff's approval of the type of fencing for neighbors?
Yes, that would be our recommendation.
Okay.
We've actually included that as a note on our updated plan.
Right. Someone else back there wanted to come forward? Is this in favor or opposed?
Opposed.
Yes.
Do you want me to say my name?
You've been sworn in. Go ahead.
Carol Ann Hine. It has once again been brought to the attention of the St. Pat's Neighborhood Association that another predatory lending car dealership is requesting a variance to locate in our city of Joliet. Even though Drive Time is not requesting to locate in our neighborhood, it is requesting to locate in our city. At some point in the past, we had thought that there was a consensus by the city that this type of business does not contribute to the economic health and improvement of the city of Joliet's plan for a big picture plan for the quality of life. We are committed as a neighborhood organization to continue to work with the city of Joliet on the quality of life action plan. In reviewing the information that has been provided to us about Drive Time to justify their credibility, it falls short of being totally upfront. If you go to the Better Business Bureau site, there are many complaints about Drive Time, in particular that they will charge sometimes 2 times the value of a vehicle, finance the customer, and then they will be paying off a vehicle that is way under the Blue Book value for many years. When CarHop, which was a well-known easy credit used car dealership, was trying to locate into the city of Joliet, many neighborhood organizations voiced their opposition to this. The zoning board and staff did not recommend the variance to the city council, and the city council unanimously denied it. We hope that the zoning board will not recommend Drive Time for this variation of use and find that this is not a business that we would like to encourage to locate into our city. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else? Swear the evidence you're about to present is the truth under penalty of law.
I do.
Name and address.
I'm Bob Nachtrieb. I live at 614 Western Avenue, and I'm on the board of the Cathedral Area Preservation Association. I stand with Carol Ann, but I would like to add that what has been presented sounds good, and it sounds as if they were to do that, maybe they would drive some of the more predatory outfits out of business. But this outfit also has a checkered past. Its two principal owners pled guilty to fraud in the Lincoln Savings and Loan scandal of the 1970s. And 2 years ago, they were fined $8 million by the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau for harassing people who are delinquent in their credit. So I would be careful about approving this petition. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else? Anyone from the petitioner would like to respond to those statements?
I think we have addressed the predatory lending aspect or accusations of our business. It's not part of what we do. As far as the CFPB fine that we received a few years ago, that investigation stemmed from 2009 to 2012. It focused primarily on our loan collection and credit reporting. It had nothing to do with car sales or financing. We worked very closely with the CFPB, provided them over a million documents, adding up to over 3 million pages of information. And we took it as an opportunity to better our business, learn and grow as a company, and we found it as a benefit.
I believe I previously addressed some of the predatory issues or lending issues and concerns. And I reiterate that there are a lot of misconceptions about subprime lending, but there are also a lot of benefits. There's an extreme amount of benefits, especially to those who've had financial difficulties in the past. And my client provides that services, and they take pride in providing a good service. And they have a vested interest in the game and the success of these loans by maintaining the loans, maintaining the servicing of those loans. We would ask that you allow my client to become a permanent member of the City of Joliet, and you allow them to provide this incredible benefit to the citizens of Joliet, that you provide people who've had financial difficulties in the past the ability and the resources to not only purchase an affordable vehicle, but to purchase it responsibly, to restore their credit, to ensure they have a vehicle, to have a job. Thank you.
Okay. We've gone through that. Any comments by the board at this time? Chair is going to close petition to the floor, ask the board for discussion and a vote. Motion would be in order.
I'm going to move to deny this motion.
I'm going to second.
We have a motion and a second to deny the petition. Call the roll.
Ms. Darley?
No.
Mr. Ferguson?
No.
Mr. Graham?
Aye.
Ms. Navadas?
Aye.
Ms. Powers?
Aye.
Mr. Riggs?
Aye.
Mr. Hennessy?
We have 4-3. I'm going to vote with the majority. Vote aye. Okay. Petition 2613, Jose Paramo.
Petition number 2613, the applicant is Jose Paramo of Paramo Properties, LLC. The owner is William DeZira, and that is the family trust. Location, 1400 Essington Road. Mr. Paramo's request is a variation of use to allow a digital printing business, which is a B1 neighborhood business type use in an RB restricted business district. The applicant requests a variation of use to allow operation of a digital printing business in an existing professional office building located at 1400 Essington Road, which is the northeast corner of Essington Road and Citadel Drive. The professional office was formerly a dentist office. Under site-specific information, the site is zoned RB, restricted business. The property is comprised of a 20,000 square foot one-and-a-half-story frame structure, a full basement and second-floor storage area. Under surrounding zoning land use and character, the land used to the north, south, and east is undeveloped and zone B1, and that's neighborhood business zoning. Land use and zoning further to the east is multifamily residential, zoned RP4, which is multifamily planned unit development. And further to the south is commercial, zoned B3, general business. Land use and zoning to the west is single family, zoned R2, single family residential. Applicable regulations are as noted. The Community Design Review Board met on April 7th. There were no comments regarding this request at that meeting. Under general discussion, the applicant is requesting a variation of use to allow the operation of a digital printing business located in the north half of the former dentist's office. The structure was built in 1970 and remodeled in 1991. The site plan and floor plan are attached. The property has adequate off-street parking to serve the proposed use. The addition of a solid 6-foot-high visual screening fence is recommended at the east edge of the parking lot. Conditions: one, that the existing off-street parking remains in the future. Two, that the property owner install a 6-foot-high visual screening fence at the east edge of the customer parking lot within 60 days of approval. Three, should the property be declared a public nuisance, it shall be subject to a rehearing and a possible revocation of the variation of use. And finally, we have included the 180-day condition that a certificate of occupancy or building permit is obtained within 180 days of approval. And that concludes the staff report, Mr. Chairman.
I swear the evidence you're about to present is the truth under penalty of law.
I do.
Name and address.
Jose Paramo, 24626 Coachford Court, Shorewood, Illinois.
Comments?
As Mr. Jackson said, I'm requesting a variation of use for the property there at 1400. You're probably familiar with it. I currently have the opportunity to purchase it. It's sitting vacant right now, but I wanted to be able to, rather than have it vacant, move my business into there. We currently run the business just really down the street at Minuteman Press.
So are you in the process of purchasing it now, or?
Yes, well, one of the conditions would be that I get the variation zoning. Of the zoning. Only because, again, the empty building, it's not gonna do me any good. I'm not even, you know, it's not even 100% sure that I would move it, but I want to make the business, but I wanted to have the variance in case I did. Chances are I would if that's the route we went. It's a digital print, it's business to business. We have very little traffic, really, foot traffic going in. I have two employees, so really it's myself and a couple employees. And really just when people would pick up orders would be about the only traffic. We offer free delivery, so most of our customers take advantage of that. So I have no problem erecting the fence, although in my opinion it would take away, maybe the residents wouldn't even like the view of the fence. They've had the building there for a while, but I have no problem erecting it if that's what we need to do.
So you're not even certain if you're going to be moving in there. So what, you're just speculating on this?
Well, I want the approval so that I can move it if I buy the building. But
you have a limited amount of time to exercise that option.
Yeah, my lease is up at the end of August. So I'm requesting for the variation so that I can.
Okay. Any further questions by the board?
Yeah, how much equipment do you need to bring in to get your business started there?
We have two digital copiers right now. That's what we would move in there.
And how many employees do you have?
It's just two right now, plus myself.
Anything else? Anybody in the audience wish to speak in favor? Anyone opposed? Sir, come forward. Swear the evidence you're about to present is the truth under penalty of law?
Yes, I do.
Name and address, please.
Bill Fleming, 1417 Citadel.
I'm in the condo, the closest to the northeast corner of the parking lot. My bedroom's about 80 feet from the northeast corner, and as they pull up the drive, lights, if it's dark, shine into our living room, and I'm happy to hear about the screening. I do wish the president of the condo association was available today. She's out of town to discuss the screening. She actually didn't know anything about this over the weekend. But with the offer to screen, and you're only going to have a couple of people working there and very little traffic coming in and out every day, I'm not as opposed to it as I was before I heard this presentation, but I still do have concerns. The neighborhood is primarily retired people. It's very quiet. And again, the hours of operation, I think I missed.
I think I did too.
I guess I'm not as opposed to it as I was when I got here. Thank you.
Should have stayed home. But enjoyed your company.
Obviously.
Anyone else wishing to speak?
As long as you're a good neighbor.
Can I see? Did you raise your hand, ma'am?
No, I didn't.
Oh, okay. Are we all through then? Anyone else? Any other comments by the board? Your petition is being closed to the floor by the chair.
I have a motion. Motion to approve with the said conditions.
Is that the fencing?
Yes.
Second.
We have motion and second to approve, subject to the conditions as stated. Call the roll.
Mr. Riggs?
Aye.
Ms. Darley?
Aye.
Mr. Ferguson?
Aye.
Mr. Graham?
Aye.
Ms. Navarez?
Aye.
Ms. Powers?
Aye.
Mr. Hennessy?
Aye. Thank you.
Thank you.
Edward Kapinski. Petition 2016-14.
Petition number 2016-14, the applicant and owner is Edward Kapinski, location 750 North Broadway Street. Mr. Kapinski's request is a special use permit. The petitioner is requesting approval of a special use permit in order to allow the relocation of an auto repair facility that includes sales of used vehicles and auto parts. The 15,000 plus square foot site is zone B3 general business and currently contains a two-story 5,924 square foot block building that was built in 1925. It was most recently utilized for the artistic signs business, which has been closed for a few years. Adequate parking is available within the front and back parking areas. Surrounding zoning, land use and character to the north, commercial is B3, and that's general business. To the south is institutional, B3. To the east is undeveloped, B3, and to the west is commercial, B3. Applicable regulations are as noted. The Community Design Review Board met on April 7th, and there were no comments regarding this particular request. Under general discussion, the petitioner is requesting the special use permit in order to relocate his existing auto repair and sales business, which is Symbolic Customs, Inc., from its current location at 753 North Broadway Street to this new location. The operation will remain the same as is being conducted currently, servicing vehicles with new parts, sales of new and used parts, and minor internet sales of vehicles. Vehicles for sale will be stored and shown solely within the building, and all repairs will be conducted inside the building as well, within the four existing garage bays. Hours of operation will remain as Monday through Friday, 9 a.m. to 8 p.m., and Saturdays, 9 a.m. to 6 p.m. The business is closed on Sunday. If the zoning board desires to recommend approval of the special use permit, the following conditions would be included: that there would be no long-term storage and the maximum would be 10 days of inoperable vehicles on site. Also, we've included the 180-day condition requiring a building permit or certificate of occupancy being obtained no later than 180 days of the effective date of approval. And finally, should the property be declared a public nuisance, It shall be subject to a rehearing and a possible revocation of the special use permit. And that concludes the staff report, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. To swear the evidence you're about to present is the truth under penalty of law.
I do.
Name and address.
Barbara Kopinski, 753 North Broadway, Joliet.
Why are you moving?
Actually, we decided to just expand. We're going to stay in the current location and expand our business across the street.
Is there any history of having problems with the previous location, the city, Mr. Chairman?
No, we haven't had any complaints.
Okay.
So you're going to operate both?
Yes.
Are there going to be any repairs done to the building or anything?
I'm sorry?
What are you going to do with the building?
We're going to improve the location. We're going to do major improvements to make it look nice.
Such as, could you give us an idea?
We're going to put in some big windows. We'll just clean up the place.
City have any special requests there? Cars, repairs, or anything?
No special requests.
It says you'll be selling used parts. What do those entail?
Those would be the rims for the cars.
The rims going to be shown in the windows?
In the windows, yes, or in storage on the property.
And you'll have it across the street as well?
Yes, we're not too sure on what we're going to do in each location. We're just going to somehow just expand our business. We're going to probably have the showroom in one area, probably across the street, and keep this where we're renting now to do the work.
Any other questions? Anybody in the audience wish to speak in favor? Opposed? Chair closes the petition to the floor. Ask the board for discussion and a motion.
Motion to approve.
Second.
We have motion and second to approve the petition. Call the roll, please.
Ms. Darley?
Aye.
Mr. Ferguson?
Aye.
Mr. Graham?
Aye.
Ms. Nevadas?
Aye.
Ms. Powers?
Aye.
Mr. Riggs?
Aye.
Mr. Hennessy?
Aye. Thank you. Okay. 2617 CL2 Corporation. Anyone here? Petition 2016-17.
Petition number 2016-17. The applicant is CL2 Corporation. The owners are Catherine Beavers, Lolita Monsayek, and Lourdes Fernandez. Location 79 South Caguan Street. Their request is a variation of use. The petitioner is requesting a variation of use to allow a two-unit residence, which is an R3 one and two family residential type use in an R2 single family residential zoning district. According to available tax assessor's records, the subject structure was built in 1900. The site history for the property, as found in the Joliet Polk directories, show the property was a single family structure until around 1920. When it was converted to a two-unit residence. It was noted as a two-unit residential use and zoned R4, medium-density residential, in the 1980 Southwest Neighborhood Plan. As part of the recommendation of that plan, the subject area was reclassified to R3, one and two-family residential. The subject site was further reclassified to R2, single-family residential, as part of the St. Pat's Area Downzoning Plan, which took place in 1992. A previous owner filed a variation of use to allow continuation of a two unit in January, and I'm not quite sure of the year, and it was recommended for denial by the Zoning Board of Appeals at their meeting. The applicant withdrew the petition before proceeding to the City Council and was to present a plan and convert the structure back to single family within 6 months or face legal action. It is believed that the current owner purchased the property sometime in 2015. Surrounding zoning land use and character: to the north is R2, to the south is R2, to the east is R3, and to the west is R2, and the land uses are all residential. Applicable regulations are as noted. The Community Design Review Board met on April 7th. There were no comments regarding this particular request at that meeting. Under general discussion, the two-story frame structure presently contains a two-bedroom unit on the first floor and a one-bedroom unit on the second floor. Off-street parking for one car is provided within a gravel area in the front yard. The structure was inspected for property status in 2015 by Neighborhood Services Division, where it was discovered that it was being rented as a two-unit. A full reinspection of the property was scheduled for April 13th, and that was after the writing of this particular report. An addendum follows, which I have here and will read into the record. And a reinspection of the structure was completed by the city's Neighborhood Services Division on April 13th, and the list of violations is attached. If the zoning board desires to recommend approval of the variation of use, the following conditions would be included: that the list of violations on the Neighborhood Services inspection report be corrected, that the property not be expanded in the future, that off-street parking remain in the future and be paved within 30 days, and that the owner participate in the city's landlord training and tenant screening programs. And finally, should the property be declared a public nuisance, it shall be subject to a rehearing and a possible revocation of the variation of use. And that concludes the staff report, Mr. Chairman.
Yeah, question before we get into this. You say here that a previous owner filed a petition in 2016 and that the current owner purchased it in 2015.
Should yeah, I think that was a typo.
I hope it was.
Yeah, that's kind of why I skipped over the year.
2006.
Is there a copy of those minutes? Do you have that on the screen anywhere? I mean, it says see attached, but is that anywhere in this program? There it is.
Everybody through with that?
Mm-hmm.
Everybody updated?
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Are we set?
Yes.
Okay. Let us swear you in, please. Would you raise your right hands?
Yes.
You swear the evidence you're about to present is the truth under penalty of law. I have all your names and addresses.
Catherine.
Into the microphone, please.
Catherine.
You can lower that down. Lower it down.
Okay. I'm Catherine Beavers, 2561 Gulfview, Joliet, Illinois.
Okay. Are the other people going to speak?
Lourdes Fernandez, 16 Sims Drive, Glendale Heights, Illinois. Lolita Monsiah, 888 Westfield Courts, Geneva, Illinois.
Thank you. Any comments you'd like to make?
Just that when we purchased the property, it had never been changed back to a single family. So we went to Neighborhood Services to see what, you know, if everything was okay. And at that time, they didn't have, I guess, all the information on the property. It was in the building department. So they didn't know about the stuff that was in '06. So we went ahead and rented the property out.
We have a gentleman in there that's a truck driver, that's seldom there. And we had a Cornerstone client. Neither have cars, so there's not an issue about parking, nor have we ever had the police out there for anything. We take pride in renting good, stable apartments. I took pictures. I don't know if you would like to see the inside of one of the apartments, but we've never had any problems with the tenants there.
How many other properties do you own?
Oh, God. We have two other properties together, partners in this venture.
Okay.
I went ahead and took pictures of the inside of the property in case someone wants to see them.
I'm looking at this picture where you said that nobody has cars, and I see two cars on this gravel parking
area. Those are not our cars. Those are the neighbors, next-door neighbers.
They park on your property?
It's a shared driveway.
Mr. Chairman, if I could direct your attention to the picture. If you look behind the house, you'll see a chain-link fence that's kind of going up the hill. That's roughly where the property line is. So if you draw a line to the front sidewalk, you'll see where the vehicles that are parked are actually on the south side of that property line, which represents the property to the south.
I see.
This subject lot has the single off-street space, which would be right next to the car, just
right
north
in front
to
of
the car.
Garbage cans,
right.
That's where it belongs.
Yes.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. I also noticed that it's not paved.
Right.
Those are not our tenants, but they don't have vehicles. Those are the neighbors. It's a shared.
Right, but your part has to be paved.
Yes. We have no problem complying with whatever neighborhood services.
I don't see where it's paved. Where's
so you have many properties, so you knew that this was a single family, zoned single family.
No, we did not know.
Well,
I think
if you are in the business, this is your business, and you have other transactions, you would check that out.
That's what we did. That's what we did.
Before you purchase it, so you had to have known this was single family going into
no,
it.
No, we didn't.
Well,
it was set up
decision.
As a two-unit. It had, I guess, the last person that purchased it didn't convert it back to a single family.
So there were renters in there when you purchased it?
No. No, there
were not. So that was the automatic downzoning that we did back then. And what the owner at that time petitioned to maintain the two-unit, but he never filed? Is that?
The owner petitioned to maintain the two unit, and I believe it was denied by the zoning board. And before it got to the city council, the owner withdrew the petition and stated that they were going to, at that time, convert the two unit back to single family. Mm-hmm. I think it sort of dropped off of planning's radar screen at that point.
So it sat there.
Right.
Illegally for all that time.
Did you make any repairs to the building before you rented it?
Yes, we did. Cleaned up the floors, their hardwood floors, painted each unit, put carpeting in the units upstairs. We went to neighborhood service prior to purchasing it, but the reason they didn't see the repair of this, all this stuff that you're presenting today is what they told us. It was not in the computer because it was with the building department.
Is this divided inside? The upstairs one unit and the downstairs
yes,
is another?
That's the upstairs unit through that door to your right, and then this is the downstairs.
And you've got full kitchens and baths in
right.
both units.
Mm-hmm. Is so there just
an inconvenience way to take that?
Not really.
Go ahead.
Is there just one parking spot for this in the front then?
Yes, they have off-street parking. But they don't. We usually rent to clients that are disabled or veterans, and they don't have cars.
I'm looking at the list of violations that was inspected a week ago,
mm-hmm.
and some of these are cosmetic, but there's a lot of safety issues with electrical, with handrails missing, with illegal wiring. Ceiling height, there's some major things because it was illegally converted.
Do you have a list of these violations?
We can't do anything. We just got the list on, I think it was the 13th, but we're not allowed to do anything after hearing today. We did not have the list prior because when we went to Neighborhood Service, they wasn't aware of this stuff until it.
But you must have noticed yourself that there were certain things wrong with the property.
There's no, with the.
I mean, you must have noticed some of these violations yourself without being told.
No, the wiring, he said, has to be in conduit. I have the violations here. No, if you want to see the pictures, you could see. There's nothing sticking out. He's saying it has to be in conduit. Electric has to be in conduit, not properly secured, is what it says. A ground's missing, properly grounded, so you wouldn't just notice that. Chimney needs to be cleaned. Fix the sink, underneath the sink. No.
The junk and the discarded appliances, I mean, you didn't notice, but now there isn't, but there must have been on the 13th. I mean, that wasn't something that you.
This is an old list, he told me. According to Gabe, this is an old list, and he just copied from the list prior to us. None of this stuff is there. There's no, it says remove junk or discard appliances or tires. None of this is there. He copied an old list of some of this stuff, is what he said to me. None of this is there.
So they didn't inspect it on the 13th?
So it was inspected or it wasn't inspected on
it? It was inspected.
So all these violations are from the 13th?
But Ms. Beavers is saying no. She's saying that.
We're getting two sides here. What's correct?
Yeah, I think this is representative of what they found when they were there on the 13th.
Okay,
thank you. Okay, I don't outside. Okay. Yeah, we're not sure where the appliances and tires would have been. Yeah. Was there anything in the backyard?
No. Yeah, could we see some more pictures of this? I mean, could you go through these again on here, the outside? Yeah, see, there's pictures.
None of that stuff's there. That's
and there's three satellites.
That's not the way the way it looks now.
Why are there three satellites on the top?
That's before. This is now.
Okay.
Yeah, those are the pictures before.
Before what?
When
a week or 2 weeks ago. But there's no appliances or garbage outside.
There's none of that stuff.
You might have picked it up.
It looks like there's stairs missing, too.
I know, that's not our building.
We don't have this.
This was from a week or 2 weeks ago when I was out there and took these pictures.
Yeah, but none of this stuff, no junk, appliances, tires, none of that stuff there.
That was not outside.
No. It said exterior, though. That's what's my concern.
Yeah.
And there's nothing out there.
It does say exterior.
This is exterior.
Mm-hmm. It does say exterior.
I'm wondering if this is just a code that includes, because if you notice, it says remove junk or discarded appliances and or tires. So that could be a descriptive code. Right, just to remove the junk, but not that there was necessarily a discarded appliance or tires on site. Yeah, that's probably.
So you don't have three satellite dishes on the roof anymore? I mean, there's three in the picture.
Not that I'm aware of. Maybe it is. I'd have to relook that. They have cable there, so they don't even have satellite.
guy in the dancing table, do we get some of this stuff straightened out? I don't know what the hell's going on here. So what we're saying is, you know, that all these violations are questionable. Could you have all this done with, what was the time limit on that? 90 days to have all this done if it were approved?
We could have a contractor out there and do that.
Kennel?
Well, it says the list of violations on the Neighborhood Services Inspection Report be corrected. There was no time period, but we can certainly include that.
So if all these were there on the 13th of April, it's been a month. How many?
We were told we couldn't do anything, though, until after we come here. That's why we didn't do any of this.
Well, but you own it, don't you?
Yeah, we couldn't, Kendall, we couldn't do any repairs until after.
I think what Neighborhood Services was stating was that they needed to go through this process first in the event that it doesn't get approved.
We would gladly have had the repairs.
Some of the stuff is going to have to be done regardless, though.
Yeah.
Whether it goes to single family or stays two, you know, it's still going to have to be done.
And we don't have a problem
from people in the audience.
We're told not to do anything until after the hearing.
Is there anybody in the audience interested in this petition? Let's hear from you, sir. Are you in favor or opposed?
I'm in favor.
Come on forward.
See what you have to say. There are people here opposed that I'm aware of. There are people here opposed that I'm aware of.
Yeah, we'll
get to them.
Do you swear the evidence you're about to present is the truth under penalty of law?
Yes, I do.
And your residence? Do you live in the building?
No, I don't.
Okay, could I have your address?
207 Sheridan Street, Joliet, Illinois.
And your name, sir?
Larry Turner.
Okay, your comments?
I work with all three of these ladies on their houses. I worked on that house, downstairs and upstairs. I did the drywall, pastel repair, and the painting of the building.
Have you seen this list of violations?
No, I haven't. But I worked on the building prior to that, and the city passed it.
When was that?
That was back in 2015.
Have you done any work since then?
Not on the building yet, but I'm quite sure if they need me, I'll help out.
Okay, thank you for your comments. Is anyone opposed to this out there?
Over here.
You've been already sworn in. Go ahead. Just give your name and address.
Carol Ann Heineman, 711 Morgan Street, Joliet, 60436. My name is Carol Ann Heineman, President of St. Pat's Neighborhood Association. This home is in our neighborhood. I'm here to express opposition to the variance to allow the building at 79 Cagwin, located in our neighborhood, to be a legal two-unit. There are also a few neighbors from Cagwin Street here to support the opposition of the variance of the unit. They live on Cagwin Street. As a neighborhood organization, we are opposing the request to give 79 Cagwin a variance to be legal. The important thing right here, however, is that it's currently illegal. It's divided into two units and occupied. A two-unit rental must provide at least 1.5 parking spots per unit. That is not provided. They're saying right now that they don't have people with cars in the unit, but what if there are? They need to. It's an ordinance. There's a small area next to the house, but it. My understanding is that, like they had explained, that parking area is the owners to the neighbors. So they just have one little slot there for parking. Cagwin Street, where this house is located, is a one-way street with parking only on one side of the street. It's very congested. If you drive down the street, you can see the amount of homes and cars are making the area quite congested. Not only is there not enough parking for a two-unit, the home is not kept up well, and it is once again providing overcrowding with additional occupants to an already densely populated area of the neighborhood. It is currently functioning illegal as a two-unit, and we strongly oppose the request to approve a variation for the property to become a two-unit. Thank you for your time.
Is one of your tenants from Cornerstone, you said? I mean, they're very selective of where they put their patrons that they...
We house quite a few Cornerstone clients, and I received a letter from her wishing us good luck with this. Housing Authority approved the...
Now, we're very familiar with Cornerstone. I mean, we've had them before as many times, and I know the type of dwellings and the structures they build.
We take pride in...
I'm sort of surprised that they have someone in this
having
building.
Having good, clean apartments. If we get the okay to make this a two-unit, we would gladly take care of all those repairs.
Could I see those pictures that you have of the interior, please?
Sure.
This has been in limbo for so damn long. This one of those babies that slipped through the cracks.
Furniture, yeah. Well, you know.
Outside.
We had the okay, those repairs would have been done. So we have contractors that could go in there and do those.
There's not much here. Any pictures of the rear of the house?
Some of them are the same. Thank you.
This is one of those situations that's been confused ever since it happened. When they had that downzoning, most of the people in the city didn't realize that if they didn't file for a variation, that they would lose the residency that had previously been grandfathered. And that's obviously what happened here. This is just one of those things that slips through the cracks.
This one really didn't because it was denied at one point.
Well, it was denied.
And then just kind of nothing was ever followed through. But that was...
Zoning is easy to check. You can check before you buy a property. You should always check the zoning. I think that's a simple fact.
The same multiple unit.
Okay. I'm going to close the petition and ask the board for discussion and a motion of some kind.
I'm going to make a motion, Mr. Chairman. If you looked at the minutes of 2006 very carefully, you could see I denied it back then, too. And there's falling through the cracks. There was a 10-year crack this thing fell through and still made money for that long for whoever owned it at that time. And nothing has changed, and this is emblematic of what we've been fighting there since 1992. And I move for denial.
I second.
We have a motion and a second to deny the petition. Call the roll, please.
Mr. Ferguson.
Aye.
Mr. Graham.
Aye.
Ms. Navadas.
Aye.
Ms. Powers.
Aye.
Mr. Riggs.
Aye.
Ms. Darley.
Aye.
Mr. Hennessy.
Aye. Okay. Family and Friends Adult Daycare. Anybody here?
There's Beavers, isn't there?
Petition number 2016-08. The applicant is Family and Friends Adult Daycare Incorporated. The owner is Catherine Beavers. Location 701 Abe Street. Their request is a special use permit to allow an adult daycare center. The applicant has provided adult daycare at an existing facility located at 701 Abe Street for the past 5 years. Ms. Beavers is requesting a special use permit to allow continuation of the nonconforming use. The petition was tabled at the March hearing due to the need for additional information about the current land use at the site. In October 1990, the Joliet City Council approved a variation to allow an existing tavern at the subject site. site-specific information. It's located at the northwest corner of Elwood Avenue and Abe Street. The existing commercial structure is the former location of Joliet Eastside Athletic Club. The property is comprised of a lot that is 7,920 square feet. Also included in this request is an 11,880 square foot paved parking lot, which is located directly east of the site. The property is zoned R2 single family residential, and that's the parking lot, and R3 one and two family residential for the main building. Surrounding zoning land use and character, the land use and zoning to the north is one and two family residential zoned R3. Land use and zoning to the south is single family residential zoned R2. Land use and zoning to the east and west is undeveloped zoned R2. Applicable regulations are as noted. The Community Design Review Board discussed this petition at their meeting on April 7th. However, there were no additional comments from other city departments, public utilities, or other agencies regarding the request. General discussion. The applicant purchased the subject site with the intent of converting the private social club into an adult daycare facility. The Family and Friends Adult Daycare Center is inspected and licensed by the Illinois Department of Human Services. All applicable permits necessary to meet state standards have been secured. The existing commercial structure is 4,160 square foot, made of brick and block, and built on a slab in 1950. A site plan and floor plan were made available. The facility includes a kitchen, large day room, activity room, banquet room, office, and several bathrooms. The adult daycare center has adequate paved parking for up to 20 cars in the blacktopped parking lot, which is located east of the building across Abe Street. Should the board be inclined to recommend approval of the special use permit, it would be subject to the following conditions. Number one, that the center hours of operation not exceed 8 a.m. to 6 p.m. Number two, that the property shall not be expanded in the future. Number three, should the property be declared a public nuisance, it shall be subject to a rehearing and possible revocation of the special use permit. And finally, we have included the 180-day condition requiring a building permit or certificate of occupancy being obtained no later than 180 days of approval. And that concludes the staff report, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Okay, we tabled this in March for some additional information about the current land use. What did you find out since that time?
Neighborhood services had some concerns about a possible tenant in the building, and there was an inspection that was made, and that was all cleared up. I think they got a clean bill of health from neighborhood services, so we're here.
So
today.
Whatever those problems were don't exist anymore.
Right, yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I swear you in, please. Just raise your hands. You swear the evidence you're about to present is the truth under penalty of law?
Yes.
Names and addresses?
Catherine Beavers, 2561 Gulfview Drive, Joliet.
Thomas Beavers, 2561 Gulfview Drive, Joliet, Illinois.
Any comments you'd like to make?
We've had the adult daycare for some time now. Prior to running the center there, we were located at 105 McDonough, and we moved there. We did check with neighborhood services. Everything seemed to be okay. I guess later on, Jeff Sturr checked and said it wasn't zoned properly or something. So that's why we're here today, to make sure we're in compliance.
And you've complied with all the state requirements and recommendations?
Oh, yes.
Licenses and everything? What's your background and experience in conducting a business such as this?
I'm a respiratory therapist. I worked at St. Joe's for 20 plus years.
20 years?
Yes, my daughter has her master's degree. She runs the business, she's the director there. We have a nurse there on staff, a nurse's aide, and an activity director, and a certified cook.
Okay, thank you.
How many clients do you have?
Currently, right now, we have 17 or 18. we had 34.
So, but you've been running this now for 5 years?
Yes.
So it took 5 years to figure out the zoning on this one, is that?
I did my due diligence. Okay. I went to the business department, which you don't have to have a business license, and I went to neighborhood services. I went to both.
Any other comments by the board? Anybody in the audience wish to speak in favor? Anyone opposed? Chair closes the petition to the floor. Ask the board for discussion and a vote.
Motion to approve.
Second.
We have motion to second to approve the petition. Call the roll.
Mr. Graham?
Aye.
Ms. Novatis?
Aye.
Ms. Powers?
Aye.
Mr. Riggs?
Aye.
Ms. Darley?
Aye.
Mr. Ferguson?
Aye.
Mr. Hennessy?
Aye. Thank you. All those in favor of approving the minutes of last meeting, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those in favor of adjournment, so signify.
Aye.
Aye.